Hello and welcome to another useful video. Right, so we're going to be doing what are we going to be doing? We're going to be doing section E of Maiden Voyage, Rockschool Grade 3 Maiden Voyage, right? There are videos of me playing this, the whole piece, and also there's other videos of me doing going through the ad lib develop sections, so where you get a bit creative and ideas for that. But for the minute, we're going to learn an actual section of it slowly, bit by bit. We're going to learn section E, I think, which is the same as section A. The first line of section A is the same as section E, so it covers a couple of things there. So the first half of A as well as it's the same as E, right? So that's pretty good. So, stems down, ready? Stems down only. The count goes. I'll whisper the rest, okay? One, 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 two, and three, four. One, two, and three, four. One, two, and three, four. One, two, and three, so play that. Let's play it, ready? Just give me a second. That's better. Right, so that's the bass drum part. The stems up part, yeah? We're on section E, which is, by the way, page 19 or page 2, right? And it is bars 34 up until including bars 37. Let's get crazy. So, the stem's up. Let me just play it first, actually. Oh, you probably couldn't hear that, could you? I'm trying to get used to this. Oh, it's too much. I'm saying I'm going to play the stems up part. Of section E. Section E is bars 34 to 37, up to and including bars 37. Right, so stems up, I'm just going to play the stems up before explaining it, right? So here we go, ready? So I've got to turn that off. Turn off the vocal mic onto the drum mic. So slowly the stems up only, ready, goes. Hang on. Bit slower. I'm going to do an eighth note counting, yeah, because it's so slow, but it fills the gaps a bit more. An eighth note count as opposed to a quarter note count fills the gaps in the counting. Ready? One and two. I'll do three, four, and one slower. Two. Okay, so as you probably figured, yeah, the accents feature on the and of three and the and of four, the and of three and and of four on every bar. Okay, so when you play an accent, you've got to lift the stick higher than what ordinarily you would. So you can see, you can either snap the stick back like that, so it comes back to there for the accented notes. When the other non-accented notes probably start around there. So accented, non-accented. Or you can kind of arch and get a whip like that. That is a certain technique that we probably do at some point. You can try and emulate what I'm doing. It's possible that we might have started doing that very base, sort of lightly, just loosely, without getting into too much detail, or just a straight snap. But whatever you do, you need to get more height off that stick to then execute the accent. So if you're doing a snap, it would look like this. Use the power through the wrist, use the fingers to bring the stick down. Excuse me. That's the snap. And there's the kind of arch. But you can see though, they both end up starting there as opposed to a normal played note, which would be there. So if I mime it and count over it, that'd be a good start, really. One and two, and I'll accent I'll accentuate my count when the accents go up. I think, I'm just trying to think what I'm going to play. Let me play a minute. I'm trying to work out what I do. Wait a minute. I'm happy doing it both ways. For the minute, I think we'll do the snap. Just the straight up, which would look like this, really. So if those notes were played without accents, they'd look there, about that level. With accents, they're coming from there. I did say I was going to count and airstrike it. Ready? Ready? One and two and three. One and two and three and four and one and two, three and four and one, two and three and four and one, two and three and four. And four, and the other thing is, my right hand's accented as well. You could play it. There's an argument to say, because there's not accents written under the notes that are performed by the right hand, because there's not accents written under them. You could argue that you shouldn't accent them. But that's just different people's different systems, okay? Sometimes an accent over the top, especially for drummers, means to accentuate the note that the accent's not written over or written under as well. And it just feels right to do it. I mean, I think it's the best thing to do. So you can accentuate the right as well. So instead of going, you'd go just a little bit. Right, very slowly, yeah? Let me airstrike and count it. One and two and three and four and one and two and three and four and one and two and three and four and. Right, I'm going to play it really slowly. First bar, bar 34. Ready, Freddy? Slowly. I'll just keep going around that. So it's one and two and three and four. I did just apply the bass drum in there as well. So just the stems up. So just the tom stuff. And then climb together. So weave in the bass drum part underneath it all. So we got ready. So the second bar in detail. Third bar in detail is the same as the first bar. The only difference is there's not a crash cymbal kicking it off. The last bar is pretty much the same, except that it alternates between that and that. You might find that when you're doing the upstroke, which is the note that prepares the accent, so either that or that, I should have said it's the upstroke, that, the snappy one or the archy one, which then comes down to play the downstroke. The downstroke was known as the accent. You might find you're doing a bit of a halfway house between that and a little bit of arch, cool, whatever you fancy doing. But you must get plenty of volume on those accents. So if I play the whole thing without the accents, it sounds like this, really. And I'll do it at speed as well. What is the speed? 130, isn't it? So, without accents. Let's do it without accents. Without accents. Two, three. Without accents. With accents. Ignore that silly bit at the end. So I'd work that up starting at quarter note equals, I don't know, 70 beats per minute, and then all the way up to 130. So 70 would look like this, would sound like this, is a better way of putting it, isn't it? Oh, what am I doing with this thing? Let's do 80 actually. 70 is so slow in there, but if you need to do 70, do it. Do count as well. When I'm doing the count here, I find I'm best off just counting all the eighth notes for it. So when you do the bass drum part, just count the numbers you've written in for the bass drum part. So 1, 2, and 3, 4. But when you learn the higher, the stems up part, counting 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and when you join them all together, I would still count 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and. Don't count the stems down, count the stems up. When you're playing stems up and stems down, right? Let's get crazy. Here we go, ready? So 80. Let's do this. Ready for these? So slow as a snail. 1 and 2. Get any volume off this thing. Give me a second. Oh, okay, I get it. Here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4. Gradually up the tempo. Maybe you do it gradually, but let's just jump the gun. 110. Let's go 100. Ready? Here we go.
1, 2, 3, 4.
So that was quite snappy generally. If I did the more archy one, it would look like this, ready? 100 BPM.
1, 2, 3, 4.
That's probably enough stuff on that. So go slow, get your good technique, nice and triangular, sit up straight, nice and wristy, bit of arm in there, forearm in there, if you like that. Probably a little bit as well, even if you're doing a snap. Once you get up to tempo, probably, once you've got that on its own up to tempo, practice section, the end of section D into it, and then get onto the backing track. That's about it. Thanks very much and good night. Keep practicing.
Bye.